modified the ecliptic plane. This part here is called the allodeity. It's usually in the back, but you use that to align to the sun or whatever celestial object you're trying to look into, and you will align the part on the front of it to result in your orientation to the local cosmos. I should have mentioned as well, the etymology is Greek astrolabos for a star taker. But originally, it became more developed in the Islamic medieval period. They added angular scales and circles indicating the axis. In the 10th century, a Persian astronomer, Abd al-Rahman al-Sufi, he wrote a book that where he claims there were over 1,000 uses for the astrolabe, which may have been somewhat exaggerated, but it demonstrates the utility and the enthusiasm nonetheless. I guess make some examples for how they're used socially. It gained a lot of religious significance in Islam because they would use it to find the direction of Mecca and related to the time of day. But they would also use it for more seasonal events as well, such as like when to plant the seeds, when to harvest the crops, and the procession of the zodiac, and the rising and falling of the tides. Oh yeah, I meant to say, like, if anybody has like any questions at any point, like, feel free to like raise your hand and jump in. It can be helpful because my mind could be in a lot of places at once. A couple of other models of the universe to kind of build on the theme. So we see some orrery, and that's typically like a more clockwork representation of the universe. Kind of on the theme of art and science. This is from a magic card as well. I can get into that more later.
Probably is.
The armillary sphere is kind of similar. Some people will call it a spherical astrolabe. I think there are a couple of differences, but usually you'll see like a framework with celestial longitude and latitudes. The ecliptic. This is from Tycho Brahe's zodiacal armillary sphere. And so, scaling up, I want to talk about the importance of understanding our universe and our connection to it. And before I dive into the philosophy a little bit, I just want to talk about these a little bit, because I find them really interesting. So this top left, this is the Nebra Sky Disk. It's the oldest discovered representation of the cosmos from the Bronze Age, 3,600 years ago. This is Johannes Kepler's Platonic solid star system from his mysterious Cosmographicum. Kind of like using the idea of the Platonic solids and kind of like arcane geometry, how that relates to the universe. It's a metaphysical manifold for which like the rules of the universe emanate from. The bottom left, that's a representation of Anima Mundi from Robert Flood. And the notion of the anima mundi is that all the parts of the universe are very interconnected, just like an organism and a cell. It's all hyper-connected. And the intelligence of the universe is endowed as a single being, as Plato would put it. And then the bottom right, that's just part from projective geometry. Augmenting the astrolabe, the idea is that the astrolabe represents an architecture through which we view and interact with the universe, and we come to understand our cosmic situation and the ramifications of that. And it's nice because we investigate our understanding of the universe against the backdrop of space and time. And by augmenting the astrolabe, we are perpetually divining, polymerizing, and integrating new points of view to our model of the universe. And so by assimilating new ways of seeing the universe, we enrich our understanding of it and the meaning that we gain from our lives. And the philosophical takeaways I'm hoping you guys can get, take away from this, is exploring how we fit into the greater whole is of significant import in our lives. Without understanding our connections, we can feel isolated or lost, and the more profound and in-depth our connections with, that we understand our connections with everything, the more meaning we gain. I'll get back. So when it comes down to it, the only understanding of the universe that matters is your own. Nobody is going to be able to do that for you. It's your responsibility to understand your embeddedness in the totality, to understand the spectacle of our situation. And so when it comes down to it in the end, it's your own understanding of the universe that really matters. Furthermore, the way that we speak about reality, it affects how we perceive it. The language that we use exists on multiple levels, and whether we're consciously or subconsciously aware of it, how we speak about the universe impacts how we experience it. A couple more points. So the dynamic interplay, like the theme of the event, between the arts and sciences is particularly generative of new ways of thinking about the universe. And by integrating a wide range of ideas about the universe, we can get a more holistic view of our place in the stars. And by considering all these different types of ideas and integrating them into our lives, we can rear a more meaningful and musical existence in the cosmos. Finally, with open-mindedness and curiosity, we can harness the augmentation of interdisciplinary ideas to liberate our world free from stagnation and to catalyze our capacity for courage, coherence, and creative self-expression. And now I'd like to introduce Professor Nathan Schwadron. He's a professor of physics here in the space sciences. I got the chance to meet him in his Searching Our Place in the Universe class, the first time he was taught, spring 2020, when things went virtual halfway through, but it was really, really fun. It was a really engaging class, learning about all these multicultural arcs of history, how they intertwine, and how ideas from across disciplines can inform our worldview in many different ways. It affects us, not just individually, but on the cultural sphere as well. So without further ado, here's Professor Nathan Schwadron.
Awesome, thank you. So let me get set up here.
Whatever, man. I'll edit it in post.
Oh, come on. Make sure to do it when I leave in like 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Get a nice thumbs up in post then.
Yeah, okay. That'll be the only thing that shows up. Make sure.
A few years ago, myself and a number of colleagues at the university put together a course called the Copernican Lens. And it pulled together perspectives from philosophy, from history of science, from writing, and the arts, and from physics. So all of us recognized that within how we have learned science, how we progress science, and how we're dealing with science today, there's something very significant missing. We've missed both the historical perspective, but we've also created a perspective that almost inherently drives people away from understanding the connectedness between these different realms. So in order to start to unfold that, what we've had to do is to go back into time and to look at how that synthesis was achieved and how perspectives changed over time. What we're left with is some really remarkable conclusions. And it leads up to the present day and our present understanding of science and our own views that are still incomplete. We know that they are. In order to progress beyond where we are today, we have to be able to start to understand these different perspectives on the world. And that is, you know, that kind of takes us to where we are right now within science and to some extent within the arts too. So to me, this question of perspective, first of all, and change is fundamental. We have to understand why it occurred in the past and why it's occurring now. At the end, I don't think we're left with any huge solutions. We're left with a lot of questions. But at least after having done this for a few years and having talked to these colleagues from these different realms, I feel like we're at least starting to ask some of the questions, some of the right questions, as to why it is that our current views are so incomplete. Okay, so let's see, advancing here. All right, by the way, this whole discussion that I'm giving is pretty much an entire course compacted into 20 minutes. So you guys are going to have to.
We're used to it.
So we start here. This was something that Professor Sabrina Smith put together. And when we, you know, started this, you know, I sort of started in Mesoamerica, you know, 300 BC. Sabrina, a philosopher, went back 230,000 years to the start of Homo sapiens. And that is how old we are, really. Our, you know, the Homo sapiens became a thing. It's kind of a definition, but to some extent, the social gathering, the social nature of us as a species, that's, you know, 230,000 years old. Okay, so that's a big amount of time, and it explains why we have the variability that we have. But you can also see that the motivations for us to be social creatures was, you know, many, many hundred thousand years before we even had information about written records. Now, what that tells us is that our current view on history is incomplete. It's likely very wrong, and I'll give you some examples of that. Okay, the other thing that I will say, and that Professor Smith emphasized in raising this point, is that where do we find the oldest samples of human beings? Does anybody know?
Africa?
Africa. Ethiopia is where we're finding a lot of these oldest sites. That does not mean that there aren't other sites elsewhere that we have yet to discover. But at least from what we can tell, you know, Homo sapiens came out of Africa and went to many different places. They migrated. And that's another major theme in this discussion is migration. And it's important today because we're seeing migration that's happening at this very instant. It's sad, it's awful, but it's also going to drive major change. We are all, most of us here, I don't know all of us here, but most of us here are migrants. We've migrated to this country from other places. And it's that bringing together those migrations where we often see major change happening within science. So, Katahayok, Turkey, recently discovered it's the world's oldest village, almost 10,000 years old. Has anybody heard about this? It was a relatively recent discovery. Okay, so you can sort of see in here, this is the village, and if what you see is a lot of different, what looks like homes that are right on top of each other, that's exactly what it was like. For many of these homes, in order to get into them, they were so closely packed together that you had to go in through the roof. Okay, so standard then, right? Why is it that we started to develop a society? What was it that drove that? What have we been taught that drove that? Does anybody tell me?
I
Protection?
Agriculture.
Agriculture. Protection. Who said protection? Interesting. Okay. I don't know. But guess what? This village very likely predates agriculture. That's one of the reasons for the major discovery here. And your notion of protection is very interesting because this discovery, what people are talking about it, they're saying, wait a second, if a society starts to develop into a city, and that happens before agricultural development, that tells us that something else is motivating that. Could be protection. The hypothesis that's out there is it was brain development, it was cognition. It was the recognition of roles within societies, is the realization that by bringing together a group, you could actually function as a whole better than an individual. So societal development was a form of broader cognitive development. That, by the way, is really, really interesting in terms of scientific development, right? It says that right at the base of social development, there is cognitive development. And cognitive development, the ability to think in abstract ways, the ability to conceive of models of the universe, the ability to conceive outside of yourself. Now, when I interact with my dog, Lita, she's like, on one level, she's the most selfish being on the planet. She's always looking. She would be very excited by these, especially the chicken euros. She's particularly fond of chicken. She's also one of the most compassionate beings I've ever met. She's particularly able to pick up on people's stress, on their emotional state. I think that from that perspective, if I were to look at her cognitive development as opposed to mine, she might be a more advanced being if I look at it with respect to her as being sort of this sympathetic character, as being able to read emotional states and being able to respond to them. Okay, why is that relevant here? It's relevant because we're talking about the ability to think outside of our own views. Social development depends on that. If there's a transaction, if I'm like, hey, you know, you've got that soda, and I like soda, so that soda's mine. That would be me, like, just sort of saying, hey, you know, that's I'm just thinking in terms of my needs, man. It's all good. In order to make that into a transaction, it's like, hey, man, you've got that soda over there that I would really like. I haven't tasted a soda like that. What can I offer to you in exchange? That's starting to think, for me, cognitively, that's starting for me to think not only in terms of my needs, but in terms of your needs, and even more broadly, in terms of the needs of the group as a whole. This village, this city, 10,000 years old, that blows me away, that's not going to function without that type of cognitive development. Okay, so we go a little bit deeper, and this is what I find so profound. By the way, these are some of the drawings they found near the site. This is a deer hunt, and they sort of reconstructed all the characters in the deer hunt. Very, very cute and very amazing. But the bottom line is you don't see any evidence of agricultural development. It's hunting. This is a hunting society. What is this? Is this the home of some great distinguished member of the city because they've got such a nice dwelling? It's actually not. All of the dwellings were more or less equal size. There was no evidence of hierarchy. It's amazing. And by the way, this is this reconstructed home. I don't know about you, but that looks to me like a pretty cool place to live. I mean, yeah, I'd live there. 10,000 years old, before agricultural development. And they found these figures everywhere, all over the place. We don't really know what it means, but when you find a lot of figures, often you find figures representing a deity, representing potentially some type of political angle. And now I'm reading way too much into it, but it's what I see. It suggests to me that it suggests to me that they're very interested in being well fed and feeding others. I mean that this person has some very well fed children. And here's the reading way too much into it, but I can do it because this is after hours and we're here.
Sure.
I think this might have been a matriarchal society. This may not have been a patriarchal society. It's very, very interesting to think about. Anyway, there's a lot you can read into it. It's harder to extract the actual evidence. Okay, so that's our first stop, 10,000 years ago. Our second stop is a little bit more like 2,000 years ago, and we're going to head off into Mesoamerica. Okay, right near Mexico City. And what we're going to discover there is a society, the Teotihuacans. The Teotihuacans, this is a warlike society. They took slaves, they fought wars, they would do human sacrifice, animal sacrifice. They were into it all. The Teotihuacan city itself is filled with laboratories. Laboratories where they make clay, stone, gems of all kinds. And they clearly had a very strong astronomy going on. They knew a lot about the cosmos. Okay, so first human establishment in Teotihuacan history was around 600 BC. The collapse was about 1,200 years later. So this was a society that was around for a long time, much longer than our own society has been around. They had urban and administrative central influence throughout Mesoamerica. So this was a center. It was a metropolitan center, but they didn't have a lot of enforcement. So it was powerful enough as a society that, you know, they didn't have to worry about, you know, people coming in and invading or something like that. In terms of population, up to 250,000 inhabitants. Okay, 2,000 years ago. So this was very powerful area. This is an example. This is a mural. And it shows the great goddess of Teotihuacan. Again, notice this is the goddess. Again, evidence of not a patriarchal society. And this is actually in the National Museum in Mexico City. Okay, this is an example of what the actual city looks like. You're sitting here at the Pyramid of the Moon, and you're looking out, and you're seeing over here the Pyramid of the Sun. This is the Street of the Dead. And if you look at the structure of the city, this is sort of a fisheye lens, so it's hard to see it. But it's laid out clearly in a grid. And one of the questions is, how did they actually lay out that city? Yeah?
Is that a CGI reproduction of what they think it looked like, or is that what it looks like in present day?
That's present day. That's just taking a picture from the Pyramid of the Moon.
Wow.
Okay. Now, how did they lay out the city? There's a lot of evidence that they actually used the rising and setting of stars as ways to lay out the city. So they find these particular angles, like the streets look almost perpendicular, but not quite. They're off at these very particular angles, and they're all off at the same angle. So it's an indication that they were using stars to actually lay out the city. And one of those stars that they were using, this is kind of cool, it was the Pleiades, which you can look up in the sky right now, and look at the belt of Orion,
goes up to Aldebaran, and then going further, you can see Pleiades. And guess what? When I went out today, and you can see this when you go outside, it's a very clear night, you cannot see the Pleiades, because there's something in the way, and that's our quarter moon. It's right there, right in the cluster. So that was fun. Anyway, back then, they were seeing the same constellations pretty much that we're seeing now. Maybe movements of the stars by tenths of a degree, but basically the same sky. That also, I always find sort of romantic in a way, that we're seeing the same exact sky that the ancients basically saw. Okay, now, before I go forward to Aristotle, let me just go back here. Does anybody find anything peculiar about all this? Here we have, 600 BC. We have Mesoamerica. We have pyramids. We have moon gods. We have sun gods. Does it remind you of anything?
Yep.
Yeah.
What?
Egypt.
Okay, so wait a second. These Mesoamericans, where do they descend from? They descended from, we think, the Beringians. Those were the groups that came across the landmass between Russia and the United States, northern, and then came down through, pretty much wiping out most of the large animals in the process, as there were great hunters. And so there's all sorts of archaeological evidence showing that these folks sort of came down. Now, Beringia, we know when that was, because we know when the last ice age was. Does anybody have a guess as to when that was? 10,000 years ago. So there's no way that the Beringians could have carried knowledge of Egypt from 10,000 years prior. Somehow, you just happen to have the same stuff here in more or less the same time as what's going on in Egypt at the same time. How is that possible?
Triangles are nature's shortest shape.
Ah, yes. So that's exactly the answer that Professor Smith gave. Her answer was, and is, you set up the same group, the same cognitive development, the same type of brain, the same type of, basic stuff. It's also a warm climate, You're going to get the same thing coming out. I don't buy it.
I was going to say, what about the gods, though? I can buy the shape thing, but the gods.
It's too familiar to me. My scientific eye says that there's another connection. My scientific eye, and again, I can do this because it's after hours.
Sure.
All complete, conjecture on my part. But my scientific eye says, no, there's probably a connection. And it tells me that there was migration going on, and that it was migration across the seas that we have not yet discovered. They're starting to find evidence of precisely this. Not going back this far, because most of that evidence has been destroyed. But again, I believe that this is suggestive of migrations, of the coming together of populations, which drive, guess what? Social development, scientific development, development in the arts. That's part of one enchilada, which brings us together as a society. That's exactly what I believe Chris is onto in Augmentation of Astrolabe. I think it's that type of thing. We think about it in terms of spirituality. Spirituality, to me, is the big enchilada. It's like the questions that we ask. And it drives us. It drives us as creative beings, and it also drives us as curious beings. Wanting to know what's next. That, to me, is the fundamental connection. Okay, So we're going to go forward a few years, and that, you notice that I've moved from Africa, and then I went to Mesoamerica, so now we're going to go to Greek society, the beginning of Greek society. And a lot of us, I don't know about you, I certainly, in my education, have been taught that it all really started in Greek society. Science, English, philosophy. Now we're starting to, as I'm discussing here, we're starting to find that the roots of this are probably much deeper and that we've forgotten them. But it's certainly true that in Greek society, the philosophers of Greek society brought together a lot of the lineage of models that you can trace to this day. If we look through the written record, we can find direct evidence that traces a lot of those ideas back to Greek society. And one of the biggies back there was our friend Aristotle. And Aristotle developed, Aristotle was big in terms of common sense. It's common sense that we're stationary. If we look at ourselves in relation to the world, I'm not moving. Are you moving? You're stationary. You're relaxed, right?
From my perspective.
You're not moving through space at 30 kilometers or 30 million miles an hour. You're not. That would be ridiculous. The birds would fall out of the sky. It makes no sense to say that we're not stationary. We're stationary. This is the center. This is. Remember what we were talking about, cognitive development. We're talking about the relationship of self to broader communities. We start by recognizing, oh wait, I'm not the only person hungry here. And the next step in terms of societies now is this view that we, that our society is the only one. But wait, we start to recognize other societies, Greek development, obviously Greek was had, the Greek society was very unique in developing a powerhouse that started to be very socially broad. Well, part of that was slavery. They were pulling in slaves from many other cultures. But it was the bringing together within this one society that started to give them a broader view. And now we see that that view is broad enough to encompass the world itself. And that was the advance. So what we see from Aristotle, even though from today's terms this seems very primitive, is a worldview with the world that's stationary at the center, some earth and wind and fire and all that good stuff. You can see that sort of in the center of his cosmos. Then you got the moon and Mercury and the planets. And out here, you've got the stars. The realm of perfection. Okay, so the lineage of that all traces back to Aristotle, and then you got Ptolemy, and they started to develop some models of, you know, that sort of work with this. And you know, Aristotle really liked geometry, and so he liked circles, so everybody got obsessed with circles for about 1,200 years and making sure that all the planets move around circles and models that follow circles and little circles and all of that stuff. They went nuts with it. It became very advanced. They started to get good predictions from these things. They add enough circles and little circles and going on other little circles and moving the centers around and everything, you get models that sort of work. Okay, so that was all the Aristotelian view. And I maintain that to zeroth order, even today, our society is pretty much still dominated by Aristotelian philosophy. I can't go into complete depth about it, but this view that the heavens are the realm of perfection, I think is still pretty much around today. Back then, you know, if you wanted to go lead a nation, if you wanted to go be a king, you better go find that guy or that woman that knows how to operate the astrolabe. If you can't get Chris to show you where the planets and stars and the moon are going to be in a given night, you can't make predictions, and then you can't convince the general population that you know what you're doing. You're fundamentally driven by these predictions, by the ability to predict. And if I can predict, well, you know, the moon's going to be quarter moon tonight, everybody says, wow, look at that, he predicted the quarter moon. There it is, it was a quarter moon, it's up in the Pleiades, he knew about that, he must know what he's doing. And moreover, there was a societal aspect of this, of hierarchy within society, in which these kings and queens and so forth were deriving power from those predictions.
Am I taking too long?
Or am I? You guys have got to tell me to speed up.
Oh, I'm entertained.
We're just chilling.
Yeah, no problem. And you guys, take food, be relaxed, whatever. Or ask questions. Or object. So Copernicus is now many years later. So now we're still in the West. We've come through this period of the Dark Ages in Western Europe, in which kind of science was dead. You know, the church state more or less killed it. And most of scientific development was happened, actually, the people operating those astrolabes, where were they? You told us. They were in Islam. They were in the Middle East. That's where it was happening if you wanted to see any scientific development. Okay, so we fast forward into what's called the Renaissance. As we move outside of the realm of the Dark Ages in Europe. What was it? What kicked off this Renaissance? Why was there this sudden change? Suddenly, people were interested in mathematics. Suddenly, we had what seemed like almost a renaissance, a reemergence of philosophers. It was as if we were going right back into Greek society. What in the world kicked that off? Why? Why was there suddenly this development? Why were there suddenly people interested in science again and starting to question the philosophy that the church was more or less telling everybody that had to be correct? What motivated that change?
Was there some large celestial body, like a comet or an asteroid that came?
There certainly were comets. And every time comets would come, people would freak out. And then they would go to Chris with the astrolabe and say, hey man, what's up? Like, what does this mean? It's like, well, I'm sorry. You know, your wife is going to divorce you. It's going to be really bad. You're going to lose some kids. You know, that sort of thing, you know. But fundamentally, it wasn't driven by some astronomical event. What was it driven by?
Were the predictions starting to be wrong?
That is very interesting. If you were a scientist, and you were, say, Tycho Brahe, who not only was a scientist, but he was a serious jerk, big narcissist, actually got in a duel and lost the front of his nose in an argument with somebody who, they were arguing about who was the better mathematician. You have to love the Renaissance. I mean, that just wouldn't happen today. But what was it? I mean,
was it the calendar thing where they, like the 10-month to 12-month calendar where they realized like the season thing was predicted wrong? I don't know when that happened.
Well, there's always this, the calendar thing is a really interesting thing, right? On one hand, we want to be lunar-based, which is a 30-day thing. On the other hand, we want to be, if we just used the moon, we would be off and be predicting when to plant the crops. So then you want to be sun-based. So our calendar is kind of a compromise. It's like, okay, we're going to be lunar-based, except when we're not, and then we're not. What else was going on at that period? 1400s, 1500s. What started to be a thing? Does anybody know? What was going on in, like, England?
Italy? Yeah, I was going to say, when did the pilgrims come over?
Just couple hundred years later.
Oh, okay.
It's a little bit later than that, but about the same time, but you're onto it. How did they get there?
They were fleeing religious persecution.
Well, yes. But how did they get there?
Oh, physically on a boat.
Would it be like mapping? Or, I mean, sailing, but like mapping is like a big thing, maybe?
Yeah, it was getting on ships and suddenly going to India and developing some India spice routes, right?
Migrations,
slavery, you know? I mean, it was all going on at that point, and we started to see, guess what? The same stuff that was going on in Greece, all these different societies that were coming together.
We saw that, you know, big in Italy, and then that revolution kind of moved to England after, you know, folks started to more or less topple the church. So, sudden development. Now, why would that drive change? Remember, we were talking about this is about changing perspectives in the sciences and the arts. And how does those changes come about? And at least part of my argument is it comes about through migration. So remember that in the Dark Ages, the church had done a good job of kind of freezing things, of saying, hey, look, we want to create an ordered society, and so we want you to stop trying to change our views of the cosmos. We're good with it, we've got it. On the other side, you've got innovators that realize that in order to make their ships work and so forth, they need to know more about the cosmos, and you're starting to see these same travelers coming into contact with people from the Middle East. And if you look at what's going on in the Middle East at that time, what happened in the Middle East? Does anybody know around the 1400s?
Is it the Islamic Golden Age? No, it's before that.
It's the opposite of the Golden Age.
The Dark.
You started to see the collapse of a lot of the empires in the Middle East. And the huge migration, especially of Jews, outside of the Middle East. They were going into Spain, and then throughout Europe. So you started to see, guess what? Migration. And remember that we talked about all that scientific development that was happening in these Islamic countries that was coming in and coming back through Europe. And so the scientific views that were being preserved in Islam we're now coming back in contact through various chains throughout Western Europe. I can't prove this, but there's a lot of anecdotal evidence that suggests that there was the dominant narrative of the cosmos, and then there was a narrative about the cosmos which was not the dominant. It was the one that was sort of riding underneath everything. If you think about how you know facts or narratives, a scientific explanation, there is a science going on, and then there's always other opinions, other narratives that are countering that are sort of coming beneath. They're the narratives that are flowing under the bridge. So, people started to become aware of this, and Copernicus was very likely one of those people. He was actually educated in many things. One of them was in medicine. In his studies at the University of Padua in Italy brought him in direct contact with people who knew the astronomy that had been done in the Middle East. It's very likely at that point that he started to realize that this model of everything moving around Earth was not the most natural model. And so he suggested a different model with the sun at the center. And amazingly enough, his model did not make better predictions than the Ptolemaic model. He stuck to the circles. He was still rooted in the thinking that Aristotle had given him. And so he believed that it was a much more natural solution to have planets moving around the sun. Partly because if we look at planets in the sky, we look at typical planetary motion night after night, and then every once in a while when we get close to the planets seem to go back on themselves in their orbits. That's retrograde motion, and it's caused by the fact that we lap those planets in our own orbit. That was a much more natural solution for Copernicus, for the Copernicans. Now, he published just 1 year before his death, actually the year of his death, in 1543. So you can see that he himself was struggling, I believe, not necessarily with worried about being condemned by the church, but he was actually very convinced that
the geocentric model was correct. Just had this lingering doubt, and eventually in 1543 he felt that he had enough information and he needed to get it out there. Okay, now we come to Galileo, and this is, I find, in many ways a beautiful time for the sciences and the arts. First of all, you see some of the artistic renderings of what was happening during these periods, which are absolutely beautiful. This is an example of this. And Galileo, in this case, he's using the telescope for the first time. Hans Lippershey invented what was called the optics tube. Hans Lippershey was using it not for looking at stars, but for looking at, you know, he thought he could use this to go spy on other, you know, people in other castles and maybe do some, you know, warfare with them. Galileo thought, wait a second, I want to train these things on objects within the sky. And what he saw completely changed his view. And he realized that the Copernican view had to be correct. So immediately wanted to take his telescope out and, you know, everyone he saw, he was like, hey, you know, I want you to see this. In particular, he was trying to get other powerful leaders to look for themselves at things like the moon to see what he saw and to see that the Copernican view must be correct. And the view that the church was pushing was wrong. Galileo was not opposed to the church. He had no misgivings about the Pope. He wanted to convince, he believed in truth. And so he wanted to convince the Pope that what they were carrying, their basic philosophy, was incorrect. And here we see this intersection between science and religion. Science and creativity. The creative side, the side that wants to discover, wants to be free of ideas that are passed down. Again, going right back to the views that you were talking about, Chris. Augmenting the astrolabe is, you know, sort of more generally, this idea of freeing your mind from concepts that society is placing on you as these are the only models that you can believe. Now, if you look at this image, this is one of these powerful figures in Italy, Leonardo Donato. Leonardo had his own issues with the Pope. What do you see here?
I was wondering if that's what that was.
And who's the, what's going on over here?
Is that Brian?
Does he kind of, does he look like he likes what Galileo has to say?
No.
Come on, man. That's a hater. That's a hater! So you had Galileo talking about this stuff and going out and doing, you know, things like publishing in Italian. So he's publishing in the dialect, not in Latin, you know, which nobody could understand, and therefore the church wouldn't. He was out there publishing in the medium that everybody read. So he was threatening the church. And what did you have? Within the church, you had Aristotelians. Even looks like Aristotle in the image. That's one of the, that's my interpretation anyway. That this is an Aristotelian saying, you know, be careful, this guy's dangerous. These views, he's a heretic, this guy's crazy. Don't listen to what this person is saying. I love this image. It reminds me a lot of the debates that we have going on today. It's like you kind of put Renaissance clothes on the same types of things and the same types of issues that you see playing out, even in social media. Okay, so Galileo, believe it or not, was trained not as a scientist. He was trained as an artist and as a musician. And so when he looked through his telescope and saw, these, by the way, are images that Galileo made of his observations of the moon, looking through the telescope. What did he see? He saw some shadows. species features cliffs just like we have here on Earth. This is not Aristotle's view of these like perfect orbs in the sky. And he was trained in perspective. He was trained in, wait a second, if I'm going to paint something close up and I'm going to pull away from that, I know that that's just an object that's a common object that I'm just seeing in the distance. That training allowed him very quickly to recognize that those were not special features. It was just like what we have here on Earth. This is another example. These are observations. This is a series of observations. These are all from the Starry Messenger, where he published a lot of his observations. I love this. These are observations on a sequence of days and nights looking at Jupiter and its moons. And he realizes, when he first looks at the image, he thinks, oh, well, here's Jupiter and some stars in the background. Wait a second, those stars are moving with respect to Jupiter. And he realizes that those are objects that are moving around Jupiter. Objects that are moving around something other than the Earth. It's proof, it's right in front of it. I find this to be such a beautiful image because of how succinctly he communicates this, a whole other solar system that he's seeing right there. Now, Galileo was pleading with the church to understand these views. And of course, began the Inquisition. And you can see this is a very famous position. If you look at a lot of the paintings of Galileo, as you look at the progression later in his life, there's this sort of, he's set in his views, but he's being attacked. That's my interpretation. Notice this. This is a pendant. This is a cross. He's still very rooted in the church, but he recognizes that he's being defeated. And so he gets, he needs to stay in his house and not do all these writings and not go try to, convince people with the telescope of his unique views on the universe. And so he's resigned, and he goes off and writes a text on mechanics. It's more complicated than that. But we move now from the Italian Renaissance into the English Renaissance. And Milton, who's Milton? Milton wrote Paradise Lost. He wrote a text that completely turned our own story of the beginning on its head. And he did this in England, largely because of the English Revolution, which had paved the way for scholars, intellectuals, artists, and musicians to pursue creative things and to not be so bound. It's a beautiful quote from Milton. When I've sat among their learned men, for that honor I had, and been counted happy to be born in such a place of philosophic freedom. That's this English society he's talking about. As they supposed English was, while themselves did nothing but bemoan. By the way, I love this quote too, because it shows his ability to not use punctuation. Paradise Lost, I don't think there's one period in the entire book. As they supposed England was, while themselves did nothing but bemoan the servile condition into which learning amongst them was brought. Remember, we're talking about freedom of expression, freedom of creative development. That this was it which had damped the glory of Italian wits. The Italian Renaissance is being damped out by the church, while the English Renaissance, the English Revolution, was going strong. That nothing had been there written now these many years but flattery and fustian.
There it was that I found and visited the famous Galileo, grown old, a prisoner to the Inquisition. This was when he was confined to his own home for thinking in astronomy otherwise than the Franciscan and Dominican licensers thought. These evil Aristotelians. And so he writes Paradise Lost. He turns the creation myth completely on its head. Who's that? Yeah, Satan. It's Lucifer. Lucifer's not falling to Earth. He's flying down to Earth. And from that perspective, guess what? He can view other worlds. His perspective is not bound. His perspective is more open. Again, Milton, Paradise Lost, turning that whole idea of the creation of our society on its head. And doing so while revealing themes of human enslavement and an understanding of the constraints and the problems of a patriarchal society. Paradise Lost was an encoded view of what ultimately became modernism. This is another example, and this is from the Divine Comedy from Dante in 1300, in which Dante places hell at the center, at the geocenter. This is the realm of imperfection. Up here is the realm of perfection. Is he serious? What's he doing here? Does that look like that could actually work? What's he doing here in the Divine Comedy? This is common in literature. To create a narrative that's not serious, it's a comedy. It both articulates a narrative and a counter-narrative at the same time. It's poking fun of that myth. It's saying, hey, church wants to have the view. Oh, yes, I believe that view. And by the way, there's hell right there. It's all good. But it's also not all good because it's such a ridiculous view. It's not trying to convince anyone. It's poking fun at the church itself. Without, and he does it in a way that he can get away with it. Now, let's move forward a few years later into the Renaissance. And we start to see the synthesis of these ideas into things. Mathematics like calculus. The Copernican view really takes hold. Galileo's work, but it moves into England, where Newton becomes a very powerful politician and a scientist, and articulates really a Copernican view and puts it on a scientific basis, which survives to this day. And from that view comes the notion that forces and counterforces are what control everything that we know, even biological beings. It has this incredible effect throughout society. It affects even the US Constitution in ways that we still see today. Forces and counterforces, where do we see that in our narrative about democracy and government?
Checks and balances,
exactly. Those are forces and counterforces. You don't want to have an autocracy, so you have to put in all these other checks and balances. Amazingly, it kind of works. It works until it doesn't.
Yeah.
Right.
But that was their intent, for it to be slow.
Right.
Yeah.
So that view becomes so powerful, the models become so good, that
in some ways, it looked like science was complete. Like, it's done. People were even talking about that in the 1800s. I think we're done. I think we understand all these forces and counterforces. We can make all the predictions that we need to make. We don't need to know anything else. And so then we come into the 1900s, and we see another type of revolution, and guess what? Again, it's driven by migration and change. Now, this is a time period in which I believe, this is right around 1900, a little bit before, in the late 1800s, that I think art led the way. Art was the first thing that said, hey, we need to start to question everything. This is where we started to see the Dada movement, the Surrealist movement. We saw an image of Dali already from Chris. Music, art, and government. What was happening around there? What types of ideas were floating around that were completely different? Marx?
But that was World War I era, right?
Yeah, before.
Just before. But
yeah, yeah. There was, and Marx is just one example of this, but there was suddenly a bunch of different views that, hey, wait a second, the track that we're on is maybe not sustainable. And so we need to start to think about different ways of changing the world. And it is in this realm in which Albert Einstein was educated. He eventually, his parents, who had got sort of fed up with him, stuck him in a boarding school in Zurich. Zurich was a place of a revolution. Marx himself spent a lot of time in Zurich. And artists, Dada movement, Surrealism, to some extent came out of Zurich, Switzerland. And the reason for that, does anybody know, by the way, does anybody know any Swiss history? Switzerland was already a neutral country, and so they would accept people who are political refugees. And that drove, you know, a huge movement in the arts and in the sciences. This is one of my favorite examples. It's in the age of Freud, the scientist Freud, a gastrosexual interpretation. Oh my gosh, there's so much going on there. You can't believe it. It's disgusting. It's something that belongs in a dream. But you don't want to drink your coffee from that. This is another example. This is one of my daughter's favorite pieces of art. This was Duchamp. And, you know, they were doing this. He said, he was a genius as an artist. And he said, hey, you know, I've got this incredible piece of art that I'm going to reveal. And, you know, he built it up and, you know, now, oh man, what's it going to be? Sure enough, it was called the fountain. It was a urinal. And he recognized, hey, wait a second. Just because we say there's all this high-minded stuff, that doesn't mean that that has to be art. Art is all around us. Again, notice what's happening here. It's an opening of the mind. It's exactly what Chris was telling us, sort of a freeing of the way that we think. When he did that, when he revealed his art, they had to bring in police. He was mobbed. People were so upset. And he was so happy that that had happened. He was like, wow, look at that. I provoked a reaction within society. That's exactly what I was going for. And, of course, Salvador Dali, you know, great surrealist painter. And he's painting things that are somehow directly related as allegories associated with what Sigmund Freud was publishing in his texts. This is called the persistence of memory. And notice that time appears to be bent in changing within the image. That also has a direct connection to Albert Einstein and his views that time was not fixed. Einstein, in 1905, published 5 papers. He was a patent clerk in Bern, Switzerland. He had been educated in Zurich, was finishing up, became a patent clerk, published 5 papers, which all of which were completely revolutionary in many different areas of physics. They call it the miracle year in Bern, Switzerland. Absolutely amazing that Einstein was capable of doing that. One of the ideas that he published was this relationship between space and time. He spent a lot of time on trains. He was thinking about, if I'm moving on this train, is my time set the same as the stuff that's outside the train? And he realized that there was all these experiments that were showing that no matter what frame you were moving in, the speed of light was exactly the same. And it forced him to the conclusion that space is not fixed, and time is not fixed. It's our perception that's fixed. And he was able to completely change the way that he was thinking. To some extent, it was what was going on around him which allowed him to start to think differently and gave him permission to do so, encouraged it. Now, his life was an incredible one. He became a very, very powerful figure in German society. A lot of the Nazis referred to Einstein's science as Jewish science. That is to say, they didn't believe in all this weird relativity stuff. And if you actually look in the history books, you will find that Einstein never won a Nobel Prize in physics for his discoveries in relativity. He had changed our understanding of physics. He had turned Newton's physics on its head. And yet, he got a Nobel Prize for the photoelectric effect. Now, eventually, he was forced out of German society because it had become completely unstable as Hitler was taking over. And Hitler hated Einstein, took over his cottage and made it into a little Nazi youth camp. Einstein came to the United States, New Jersey, and Princeton. And there, he started to show that, first of all, he was a pacifist on one side, but on another side, he was willing to completely oppose totalitarian thinking. In a way, during that period, and this is to some extent lost, he was also I wouldn't say a political figure, but he had a huge political impact. He was actually asked to be the president of Israel after that formed into a state. We have lost that to history. He did not want to do it. He was still fundamentally a scientist. But his life and his views had this huge worldwide impact, which helped really move us through some of the darkest times within Western Europe. His credo in 1932, I am an adherent of the ideal of democracy, although I well know the weakness of the democratic form of the government. Social equality and economic protection of the individual appear to me always as the important communal aims of the state. Remember, we're talking about this issue of migration, of social formation, of how that progresses together. And here we have a figure that seems to understand this inherently within his own personal philosophy. The most beautiful and deepest experience a man or a woman can have is the sense of the mysterious. It is the underlying principle of religion as well as all serious endeavor in art and in science. He who never had this experience seems to me, if not dead, then at least blind. This is his spirituality. It's remarkable. Okay, I'm going on forever, and I'm going to try not to bore you guys too much, and I'm going to go through some of this a little more quickly. So, we also go through this realm of quantum mechanics. And quantum mechanics starts as an accident in trying to piece together experiments and understand what's going on. There's many figures in quantum mechanics, but most of them struggled with an impossible problem. Feynman was one of the first people actually worked at Princeton while Einstein was there. And Feynman's view was that what quantum mechanics was telling us is that there's many different states of nature that all have different probabilities. And he expresses ways of those probabilities of states coexisting. And he realizes that, to some extent, the objections to that view are perhaps not as profound as he thought. He starts to actually develop a view of this that's consistent with a worldview. Big long quote, but the bottom line is that what Feynman does is to develop a picture of quantum mechanics that we can now connect with our own views of physics. But inside of it, there's a dilemma that we still are stuck with. And that is that the observer seems to change the experiment. There was a famous article that was written quite recently called, "Is the Moon There If Nobody Sees It?" And it's this notion that if we're only living in a probabilistic realm, then the existence, the mere existence of other objects depends on observer taking them in. And that seems completely contrary to our own worldview. And yet, there's this other strain going on. Remember, we were talking about my dog, me, developing a view of the world that is not just solely based on myself. And in a way, quantum mechanics starts to force that view, that broadens us, that pushes us out from thinking purely within our own realm. Yes, we are the observer, we can change the state, but outside of this exists other possibilities. Still, it's irreconcilable with our own view of reality. And this is where we need greater creative leaps to be able to put, to synthesize this in a proper view. Now you also see within this movements of art that are postmodern. This is an example of pop art from Andy Warhol. There's many different interpretations of images like this. But what's happening in my view is that the subject, the art is not about the subject. Here you have an art piece that looks like it's a picture of Einstein, but it's sort of messed up to be sort of poppy, kind of cool. This is an image of an image. We have Einstein becoming an icon. The art is that iconic view, a symbol, an expression which changes the reality itself. This is this aspect of reflectivity that we see a lot within modern art. The existence of the observer changes the perspective. The presence changes the view. It's a reflection of a reflection of a reflection. And we actually see examples of modern art in which there's performance art, where the performance itself tries to change the perspective of people around. Again, I think that this is the modern attempt to start to reconcile our own view and to move that forward into a different state, to a different cognitive state in which we can have a better relationship with reality. The other thing that's happening right now, there's many examples of this. This is a picture of our early universe from WMAP. And you see all of this data in the sky of our early universe. And it is the exact opposite of what's being sold. We have become practitioners of data. Scientists develop data. The sacred becomes the data itself. We may not understand all the secrets that it holds, but we've become practitioners of the data. This is another example of a mission that I've helped run, in which we've discovered the boundaries, the plasma boundaries around our solar system, discovered features that we never predicted. And we're still trying to reconcile and understand. In order to do that, we've had to develop instruments, place them on satellites. We spend millions and hundreds of millions of dollars in order to develop those data sets into what I would argue is an art. And you can see it right there. This is the cover of Science. And in it, you see the data and the synthesis
with a picture, a model of how that works. That has become the modern realm, is one in which truth becomes ultra truth. It becomes what becomes more absolute is the observation. The observation may not be explainable today, but it becomes the data set on which we rely for future observations. Talk about something that is opening the mind. Our data itself is more sacred than the narrative. And that is the modern truth. So I'll end there.
Thank you. Considering what Nathan talked about, and I'm going to introduce some of my favorite examples of the interplay between art and science that I hope you'll find inspiring. Let me just locate where the issue is.
I think it's the that side of the wall.
So a big part of what Professor Nathan Schwadron talked about in his presentation was how integrating these new ideas between art and science affects our perception, and how we can use that to break through the narrative that is typically imposed, and liberate our world. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about language. I'll try and zoom through this. We should be, we should be all right, about be done by 9. We should have a way to walk around here.
I've got a thing. Do you need this?
Oh, I might have to plug it in. Let me see if I think I brought my mouse. I probably should have prepared that beforehand. So I really wanted to highlight the use of the metaphor as a vehicle for understanding. And making abstractions between different types of disciplines allows us to make more comprehensive connections between them that we can build our understanding upon. By evolving our language, we evolve our consciousness. By developing new symbols through art and science to express an aspect of reality, we enlarge the capacity and bandwidth of our cognition to engage with reality. So liberating us from boundaries of thought. I wanted to mention consilience. It's just the idea of how evidence from multiple sources and disciplines can converge on stronger evidence or intimations of greater case of reality. Synergy. Just talk a little bit about the creative interplay. So I view art as impelling a feeling of possibility, because it has a freedom that it can afford that science doesn't have. It can express the universe however it pleases without systematic boundaries. In itself, it inspires a sense of possibility, because it allows us to see the world in a way that we didn't already. And so we can explore the media of art to discover our own deeper inclinations towards different aspects that's being represented in art. And coming in contact with awe is incredibly important. I would say it applied to our whole entire lives. It's the awe that allows us to dissolve the imposed narratives and the conditioning, and allows us to see the greater. It kind of transcends our individuality, I would argue. is that we are connecting to the greater whole, to the vastness of it. And transcending rationality and kind of disintegrated in different aspects of our cognition. A little bit about science. So I like to think of the metaphor as art, like it's inspiring this sense of possibility, and it's opening the doors of possibility that science can then step through and bring back a new understanding, perform experiments in these like these open rooms that art can show us that we didn't even know existed. Just a quote, art brings out the grand lines of nature. I wrote down his name, he was a French sculptor. And similarly, Shakespeare said, art holds up a mirror to nature. And to kind of invert that, I would say, rather than a mirror, I think science functions as a lens that allows us to see the different reflections and refractions of the universe. Similarly, rather than bringing out the grand lines, it's defining the visible. That we can see through empirical studies and observations and experience. I just wanted to bring up a couple of examples of kind of some blurred boundaries between art and science. So we have Maria Sibylla Marion. She was born in Germany, but she lived in the Netherlands most of her life. And she was a very accomplished entomologist. And she contributed a number of discoveries. But she created scientific illustrations about her observations that blend the worlds of art and of observation and science. And similarly, Anna Morandi, who I learned about through Sabrina Smith, who Professor Nathan brought up, she was highly accomplished in anatomy. And for a large period of her life, she was not given any scientific recognition or respect for what she had been doing. She was just viewed as an artist. She's creating these sculptures and leave it at that. But what she, not only did she extremely skilled in performing the dissections, and she made a number of discoveries about her body that were unknown. She would present lectures about anatomy to many medical practitioners, and eventually she became a professor at the University of Bologna in Italy. And so, to apply to the team, of course, it's an artistic and a scientific.
Chris, what period was that? What period was that?
Anna Morandi, I want to say, was 1600s, and let me double check. Mid 1400s. If I read that right. No, it's not in the 1400s. I must have written the wrong thing.
Putting them on the spot.
No, it's 1700s. It's not a 4th. It's just mid 1700s. I put it like that. I knew she was 100 years afterwards. Mid 1700s. Okay, I did it. And another example of Rosalind Franklin, most of you are probably familiar with. Just wanted to kind of highlight how. So she was very accomplished in X-ray crystallography, and she, of course, discovered DNA. And I just wanted to kind of give you an example of how not only does this scientific practice is, of course, of tremendous import for scientists and, of course, human from DNA, but it can be an artistic enterprise as well. We can see other electron spectroscopy, not diagrams, but results that were read in from their recording equipment. And they just as easily can experiment with artistic media through applying on scientific phenomena. This was one of my favorite examples of the interplay between art and science. John Metzinger, he was one of the first two people. He was one of the first two people to write a treatise about cubism in the early 1900s. And this this painting that he created, La Femme à Cheval, the woman with the horse, was very inspiring, very important to the world at large, because it inspired Niels Bohr, who, in developing his quantum theory, to be able to see that the world, that our observation is intrinsically linked with the phenomena that we're seeing, and that in mirroring the expression of cubism, is that we, from any single angle, we can only see one subset of reality, of the universe. So he had this like hung up in his main office, and it was one of the leading influences for him developing the particle wave duality that is intrinsic, and developing his quantum model. It is kind of hard to see, but there, especially with the lighting, but the idea is that like when you look at it from different angles, you see different slices of it, and it kind of comes together the more you envisage it from different perspectives, and that's exactly how the reality of quantum physics works. So that you have to see the more you zoom in on any part of the system, the less clarity you gain on the whole system. I wanted to bring up fractals because they're like my favorite example between art and science. And you can see them all in nature, which is super interesting. And there's just so many flavors that they come in, and you can experiment with them like with mathematical software, which is really cool as well. Typically, it is done with like a recursive mathematical formula using complex numbers, where it generates a sequence through this algorithm and creates a heat map of the values that turn into the fractals. Okay, and I wanted to bring up this video. I'm not going to play the whole thing, it's like 7 minutes, but I'll play the first like two. And this is tying into like the evolution of language, because the way that Terence McKenna speaks about the universe is unlike anything I've heard from anybody. Honestly, the way he speaks is like a fractal. And I mean, some of his ideas are incredibly far out, and like it's hard to like really make sense of them. But at least the first 2 minutes here are, for the most part, comprehensible. And just the way he wields language is incredibly inspiring. Yeah.
Was Terence McKenna the one that did stoned ape theory?
Yes. Yes. The stoned ape theory he developed it with his brother, Dennis McKenna. But the stoned ape theory is the idea that when in our collective evolution, millions of years ago, as we came down from the treetops in Africa and onto the savannah, there were psilocybin-containing mushrooms that grew in the cow pat of the ancient cattle. And so our ancestors would have spotted those mushrooms, eaten them, had these mystical experiences that would have integrated cross-domain functionality in the brain in multiple ways, bring about inspiring revolutions in culture and art and religion and shamanism, etc.
If you believe.
If you believe. That's all.
If you believe that each person's life, some larger chapter. If you believe that each person's life is a microcosm of some larger pattern, in other words, the fractal faith, what is exists as above, so below, a pattern here will have a resonance on a larger level, then why not believe that human history is like a stage in the gestation of this informational, syntactical species that is of some different order of magnitude than everything else going on this planet? I mean, we don't know what it's like to be part of a pheromone-regulated termite hive of millions of individuals, but we do know that the modalities that we create, you see, that's epigenetic communication. Pheromones, it's genetically based, but then locally variant. But our proclivity for this kind of thing, for the taking of raw matter and alchemically uniting it with ideas, with forms, these mysterious invisible things impinging into our slice of time and space from some higher dimension. We take these intimations of eternity and unite them with matter and create these things which are made of meaning and of matter, of light and of intentionality. And this tool-making process, which then has all kinds of consequences rippling through the world of cultural effects, becomes the kind of continuing carrot for our appetition for future time. And, as I said, lying at the end of this is the tool which, when correctly perceived, is seen to be the self.
It definitely covers a lot of terrain very quickly. And he has a very elaborate worldview, but kind of to sum up what he's talking about is that he views ideas as coming from a higher dimensionality of reality that we kind of tune into through some resonant phenomena in our cognition. But these ideas transcend time and space in the way that we are typically envisage them. And he will bring up the idea of like the transcendental object at the end of time, which it lies at the end of eternity, like, under the shadow of the future. But essentially, we alchemize ideas into reality by drawing from these higher orders of magnitude of the universe. And transduce it onto the physical plane.
It.
Here's another artist. It's really cool, really inspiring what he's created regarding fractals. So he's based out of Amsterdam, and I just think this is really fascinating. It's the blending of art and science to create these immersive realities that we can explore, and that kind of ties into the idea of virtual reality, which is another very significant coalescence between the arts and the sciences that strongly affects our perception of reality in innumerable ways. There are so many of the examples like that, and you can download this type of software for free and experiment with it. But tying back into Nathan's presentation, I think just like how the telescope was a piece of technology that was developed earlier in history, it allowed us to directly experience phenomena in the universe that we couldn't comprehend otherwise through the doctrinal literature. So in the same way, I'd say the visual medium and technology can allow us to experience a higher order of realness, because this doesn't necessarily exist in the outside world that we're used to, but it's still real because we experience it. And because through the technological lens, we can break down the barriers of what we thought was possible, and we can experience a more meaning in our realities. So I just want to take a couple more minutes to do the rest of this. Just kind of highlighting some polymaths, Leonardo da Vinci, of course, was huge in human history for combining the arts and the science. Study the science and the art, the science of art and the art of science. It's one of my favorite quotes from him. This is a series that he did, Turbulent Flow, where he is investigating 3D fluid dynamics, essentially, from both the artistic and the scientific lens. Zoom through a couple more. Andy Goldsworthy, modern artist, he uses scientific principles to create his art. He uses what's called the black body radiation, which has to do with how light is absorbed with collision heat. Sinatz is another really cool example of how the scientific vibrations at different frequencies in different media can produce highly complex patterns that I think are beautifully beautiful artistically, and there's kind of a deep end that I found recently with the cymatics, with like the frequencies of the universe and whatnot. But it is really neat to consider, like the top right here, those are on the right side, there's those are cymatic patterns produced in the lab, and then compared to a turtle in the ocean, which is very interesting. Nuances of vibration. This is one of my favorite artists, Daniel Martin Diaz. He really combines science and art in a revolutionary way, I would say. He studies a lot of metaphysics and circuitry and different scientific principles in a very creative way. The art on the left, that's because of the hierarchy of consciousness. You can kind of see like platonic solids and metaphysical aspects. In the bottom is binary, that's ASCII values for G and O, just go. It's actually the shortest sentence that you can say in English. Just a couple more. State of clear in transhumanism. Just as you can see, he's very liberal with the interposition of the scientific and artistic components. But I also would argue that it's visionary, and it's not necessarily a system that we can test empirically, but it opens up all these avenues in the imagination that could just as easily, maybe not be empirically verifiable, but it opens our minds to these ideas of reality might. What reality might be at the deeper levels that we can't necessarily investigate. Just wanted to like highlight some inspiration. I think one of my favorite examples between art and science is a lot of strategic games. It's very imaginative. It kind of trains you almost to think like a scientist, in that you have to be rational and strategic about your resources. And but it also allows you to express yourself very creatively in an imaginative world. Just kind of wrapping things up here a little bit. Yeah, one thing I wanted to say. Oops. So when we are augmenting the, that probably should have gotten with all that text here. it's important to understand that we're just like an individual in the greater totality, and that we only have one slice of the totality that we can perceive. But by sharing ideas with others and being open-minded, curious, and creative in our disciplines, we can augment our own astrolabe. We can enhance our view of the world by being open-minded and exploring different avenues. This is a quote by David Bohm. He was kind of like a spiritual successor to Einstein. That's how Einstein referred to him. He was also also the scientific expert for the Dalai Lama. He said, "My suggestion is that at each state, the proper order of operation of the mind requires an overall grasp of what is generally known, not only in formal, logical, mathematical terms, but also intuitively in images, feelings, poetic use of language, etc." This is where that Nathan brought up, found that in class. It's engaging with the mysterious that that really fuels the revolutions in art and science across art history. Max Planck, science cannot solve the ultimate mystery of nature because we ourselves are part of that mystery. And I think it's where art that allows us to express the aspects of the mystery that we can dive into with science. This quote from Alex Gray: every creative act empowers every other creative act. Art is an echo of the creative force that birthed the galaxies, and creativity is the way that the cosmos evolves and communicates with itself. So when it comes to augmenting the astrology, I kind of list out a few schools of thought and revolutionary ideas that can really expand your awareness, expand your understanding. And talk about quantum theory, how it goes beyond the classical cause and effect that we're used to. And like the moon, is the moon there when nobody's looking at it? It's like it's not something we can test, but we can create, we can explore those types of questions artistically. The idea of the holographic universe, reflect on the conscious, Morphic Rhythm. The implicated next layer orders are from David Bohm. It kind of has to do with some type of metaphysical substrate of reality that, before our observation is made, the phenomena exists in a super entangled state. But when we observe it, we collapse the wave function, and that brings the totality into a lower dimensionality that we perceive with our senses in the explicate order. I could ramble about all of these, that's why I don't want to talk your ear off, but if you have a specific question about any of it, let me know. And I like to apply these to mysticism and spiritual practices as well. Might alert anyone to talk about a little bit. That was from Aldous Huxley, who wrote a lot about the philosophy of the doors of perception in our minds. And so we have these cognitive mechanisms that filter out reality that isn't necessarily relevant to our survival. But by dissolving boundaries, we can experience a greater vastness of the universe. And his idea of the mind at large is that at any given point in time, we are capable of perceiving anything that has happened in the universe anywhere, which is definitely goes beyond what science is willing to play around with right now, but not necessarily have to believe it. It's just that the idea is out there. Personally, I think that it is a possibility, and I find that inspiring when I live my life. And so, when it comes down to it, I think anything that can enhance, enrich, or augment your view of reality is worth investigating with an open mind. I did bring some books that have to do with the subject. If if you want to, like, open to a random page and, like, see what that might tell you. I always think that's one exercise for you to explore. But, yeah. Peace and love.
It's my portion of the mess.